Welcome to this service this morning from Martyrwood Gospel Church with our guest speaker, Eric Parker. The service is being broadcast live, recorded, and will be available online, and is available on DVD for those without access to a computer. At church this week, we ask those present to wear a face mask, to sign in, and maintain a social distance at all times. You must not sing in church or mix with anyone outside your household. The leadership team have revised the church risk assessment and provided extra screens, a reduced capacity with fewer seats, to provide a greater social distance between people. This week the songs are provided online, and I would encourage anyone who wants to sing, please watch the service from your own home. After church refreshments are available using Zoom from 12 o'clock. This will allow smaller groups to socialise safely online. Next Sunday evening, we plan to hold a Zoom communion at 7 p.m. The Zoom codes are available on the news sheet, which is also available online. The news sheet has information on forthcoming Zoom meetings for prayer, Bible study, and social meetings. So let's begin our service with prayer. Father God, we pray that you will be present during this service, that you will hear our prayers, accept our silent worship, and guide our speaker. Prepare our hearts and minds to listen and respond to your guidance. Amen.
Amen.
Our first song is Shine Jesus Shine by Graham Kemp.
And mercy, send.
so our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Mirrored here, may our lives tell your story. Shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Grace be with grace.
Song with the plea to let there be light. And the Fellowship of Independent Churches have asked us this year to think of the year 2021 as one of optimism, to be church optimists, to be evangelical optimists. A message from them. Dear brothers and sisters, I don't know what kind of year you had in 2020 as a follower of Christ, but I know that this year ahead promises. It promises 365 days, with each day finding you nearer to the day when you will see Christ Jesus face to face and finally be made like him, bearing the image of the heavenly man. So we want to seek that with all our heart and plead with your Father for it. Believe in it. Be an optimist in 2021. Our second song is to inspire us when we take our daily walk, to pray for our local community. As it says in Jeremiah 29, verse 7, seek the peace and prosperity of the city in which I have carried you into exile. And it feels like exile when we're being sort of locked down. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. So let us remember to pray for our city, our area, when we go out for a daily walk. And we listen now to We'll Walk the Land.
On fire, and every step will be a prayer. Hope is rising, a new day dawning. Sound of singing fills the air. 2,000 years, and still the flame is burning bright. Across the land, hearts are waiting, longing, aching for awakening once again. Let the flame burn bright in the heart of the darkness, turning night to glorious day. Let the song
Please remember those people that are dear to you, those people that you want to bring to God in prayer. Let us pray. Even in the darkest moments, love gives hope. Love compels us to fight against coronavirus alongside our sisters and brothers living in poverty. Love compels us to stand together in prayer with our neighbours near and far. Love compels us to give and act as one. Now it is clear that our futures are bound together more tightly than before. As we pray in our individual homes, around the nation, around the world, we are united in one family. So let us pause and find a moment of peace as we lift up our hearts together in prayer. We pray for the health workers tending the seriously ill, for the scientists who worked on vaccination, for researchers who analyse the data and identify trends, for the media outlets working to communicate reality, for the supermarket workers and other shop workers, hygiene and sanitation providers, for the good news stories of recoveries and effective planning, for the recognition that isolation doesn't need to mean loneliness, through the offering of help and support, for the internet, telephones and technology that connects us, for the awakening appreciation of what is truly important. Thanks be to God. We pray for those who are unwell and concerned for loved ones, for those who were already very anxious, for those whose immunity is suppressed or compromised. For those vulnerable because of underlying conditions. For those most at risk to coronavirus. For those watching their entire income suddenly stream and dry up. For those who have no choice but to go out to work. For those who are afraid to be at home. For those who are more lonely than they've ever been. For those who are bereaved and grieving. God, be their healer, comfort and protection. Be their strength, shield and provision. Be their security, safety and close companion. Amen.
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 Lord, raise up your church to be your well-washed hands and faithful feet, to be present in the pain, to respond with love in action, if even from a safe distance. Hear our prayer. Restoring and healing God, thank you for medical workers everywhere, embodying sacrificial love in these challenging times, putting the welfare of others before their own, staying away from their family and loved ones, comforting the concerned and bereaved, reassuring the anxious and vulnerable, working to heal and restore people who are ill. Be their guide, strength, wisdom and hope. Amen.
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 We're now going to hear one more song before Eric Parker comes to talk to us, and that is by Robin Marg, All I Want to Tell You.
My righteousness, and I love you, Lord.
knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness.
Well, it's very good to come to share with you on this Sunday morning and to share God's word with you. I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians 15, from verse 35 until the end of the chapter. But someone may ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body will they come? How foolish. What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. When you sow, you do not plant the body that will be, but just a seed, perhaps a wheat or something else. But God gives it a body, and he has determined, and to each kind of seed he gives its own body. All flesh is not the same. Men have one kind of flesh, animals have another, birds another, and fish another. There are also heavenly bodies, and there are earthly bodies. But the splendor of the heavenly bodies is one kind, and the splendor of the earthly bodies is another. The sun has one kind of splendor, the moon another, and the stars another, and stars differ from star in splendor. So will it be with the resurrection of the dead. The body that is sown is perishable. It is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. So it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam, a living spirit, a life-giving spirit. The spiritual did not come first, but the natural. And after that, the spiritual. The first man was of the dust of the earth, the second man from heaven. As was the earthly man, so are those who are of the earth. And as is the man from heaven, so also are those who are of heaven. And just as we have borne the likeness of the earthly man, so shall we bear the likeness of the man from heaven. I declare to you, brothers, the flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with imperishable. When the perishable has been clothed with imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labour in the Lord is not in vain. Friends, we are living through such strange times at the moment. Or I might say that we are passing through a strange time.
It's not been known before. Nothing like this has happened before, as far as I know. It's peculiar. This morning, I'm going to speak about another strange time. It hasn't happened before. It hasn't happened yet. But one day, it will. When will that be? I don't know. I can't answer. But God knows. God knows when it will be. Actually, only God knows when that will be. We have read about it. We have heard about it. Actually, the Bible is full of it. We read about it just now. Listen again while I read 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51 to 53. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. Now, 1 Corinthians 15 is all about the resurrection, as I'm sure you know. The resurrection of Jesus. On verse 12, the NIV heads the verses as the resurrection of the dead. And from verse 35, the resurrection body. Without hindsight, how strange this would all appear. At the time, the resurrection of Jesus was a strange thing, wasn't it? Someone coming back to life. It had actually happened before, someone coming back to life. Lazarus came back to life. You can read about it in John chapter 11. Jesus raised him. It was one of his miracles. But the death of Jesus, his crucifixion, the disciples thought all that their dreams were gone. It was all over for him and them. According to the report in Luke's Gospel, the women who told the disciples that Jesus had risen from the dead weren't believed. Luke chapter 24 and verse 11. But they did not believe the women. Why? Because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Verse 20. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death. And they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. I'll take up at halfway through verse 23. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels. Now, that was a strange thing, wasn't it? Seeing a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. The resurrection of Jesus happened. And one day the words of our text will be a reality as well. Some will still be alive when Jesus comes again. But we will all be changed. A strange event will take place, something that has never happened before. Jesus died upon that cross. He died to put away our sins. He rose again in triumph over them. Now he has risen from the dead. He has done so with a glorified, recognizable body. Now that's important to remember, as will become clearer, I hope, as the sermon progresses. Jesus is alive, and he's alive forevermore. But the Bible teaches clearly this strange thing, which is the body resurrection of you and me. That will happen at the last day. We do not know when that last day will be. So the Bible tells us to be prepared for it, to look in expectation, to live in the light of it. Jesus Christ is coming again. The Bible is full of it. And when he comes, we will all be changed. Twice it says that in our text. We will all be changed. Verse 35. But someone may ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body will they come? And Paul replies, now it's important to understand that the Apostle Paul is not being less than polite. He is not inferring that they are silly or stupid or anything like that. Because the term signifies without reason or unthinking. So you see, the Apostle Paul wanted them to stop and think. Verse 36 continues with a farming illustration. What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. When you sow, you do not plant the body that will be, but just a seed, perhaps of wheat or something else. It has to die before it can change and become a new kind of life. When that seed eventually appears above the ground as a plant or a vegetable or something, it is not like the seed which was sown. God gives to every seed that is sown a body. So one kind of seed will produce wheat, another will produce barley or oats or something. You see, if I plant in my garden, well, I've already done this actually, the bulb of a daffodil, it will not be the bulb that will appear later, but the plant. We might say that each seed or bulb gives rise to its own body. Now, if you're following through in your Bible, then verse 39 speaks about flesh. Verse 40, heavenly bodies and earthly bodies. Verse 41, about the sun, moon and stars. And the verse ends with, and star differs from star in splendor. I'm going to read again verses 42 to 44. So it will be with the resurrection of the dead. The body that is sown is perishable, it is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. Our resurrection bodies will not be the same as we have now. Our bodies change every 7 years. If we look at photos of ourselves taken years ago, we can see The changes, wedding photographs show that, of course. Now, scientists speak are all about cell changes. And yet, we are recognisable. They can see that we are us. Your body has changed, but it is still your body. It's still you. Brown hair may now be grey. Hair may have gone altogether, but you are still you. On that day, the resurrection day, God will give you a body as he has determined, it says in verse 38. But the important thing is, it will be unmistakably you. However, it will not be identical with your old earthly body. Verse 44, it is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. Now I need to speak about this. The spirit which leaves our bodies when we die will be reunited to our resurrection bodies. How will they be? Verse 42. The body that is sown is perishable, it is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonour, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. The new body will not be perishable, subject to decay, but imperishable. Dishonour, any glory that it had, like a beautiful flower that loses it, will be raised in glory. It will have a glorified body, like the risen Christ. Sown in weakness, but it won't be raised like that. It will be raised in power. Now, one commentator has put it like this: a spirit-led resurrection body with heightened spiritual perception, we shall find ourselves able to serve the Lord Jesus Christ to the full in the world to come. Verse 42. It is sown a natural body. Now, according to a lexicon, the word natural here is a Greek adjective from soul, which means soulish. Soulish pertains to life. Now, what does that mean? Because let's be honest about it, that's not easy to understand. It means that our bodies are soulish bodies. They are adapted to this life and world. It is raised a spiritual body, which means that our resurrection body will be altogether led and controlled by the Holy Spirit. Verse 45. So it is written, the first man Adam became a living being. Now in the Authorized Version, it reads, a living soul. Adam was given a body suited to the present world. But the last Adam, the Lord Jesus Christ, has a body perfectly adapted to this risen life. And our risen Saviour is able to impart life, eternal life, to all who turn to him for salvation. The last Adam, a life-giving spirit. The Authorized Version has a quickening spirit. He is a quickening, life-communicating spirit. His risen body is no hindrance, but a help, a perfect help in all this. And we too who are saved by him will one day possess a body like his. Not, of course, that we shall all look the same, like identical twins. The likeness is a moral likeness and a spiritual likeness. Verse 49, and just as we have borne the likeness of the earthly man, so shall we bear the likeness of the man from heaven. So one day, when Christ comes again, and we don't know when that will be, we will be like him while retaining our personal identity. Now in verse 50, Paul says flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. What he means is that neither you nor I can enter heaven with these bodies, which are perishable. They must be changed. Look at verse 51. Listen, I tell you a mystery. Now, a mystery in the New Testament is a truth which is outside the range of unaided natural reason and which can be made known only by divine revelation. So in Scripture, you see, a mystery is truth revealed rather than knowledge withheld. It is a secret made known by God to us. Well, here is the secret. We will not all sleep or die, as some versions put it, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, in a moment, in an instant, as quickly as the blinking of an eye, as another version has translated. We do not die or sleep. You see, we know from John chapter 11 and verse 26 that we do not die. Whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Our bodies do. But when Christ comes again, there will be an awakening, even of the body, and we will be raised with a resurrection body. Now the wonderful secret revealed to us here is verse 51. We will not all sleep or die. Many believers will be alive on this earth when Christ comes again. A wonderful miracle, however, will then take place. We will all be changed. The dead will be raised, as it says in verse 52, imperishable. They will be raised with new, perfect bodies. We will all be changed. We, of course, being all those who happen to be living when Christ appears in glory. When will this happen? Well, I've said, we do not know. But in verse 52, we are told it will be at the last trumpet. Paul is using a Roman military term here. Soldiers were awakened by a trumpet, and they were sent into battle by the sound of a trumpet. God's last trumpet will suddenly call those of us who are still alive to a life of glory. How will this happen? Verse 51, in a flash, in a moment, reads the Authorized Version, in the twinkling of an eye. In other words, it will happen suddenly. One moment we will be in these earthly bodies with all their limitations. The next, in resurrection bodies in all their glory, clothed for the glorious environment of heaven. So no wonder then that Paul could cry out, quoting Isaiah and Hosea, "Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting?" The devil's sting of Genesis 3 verse 15 perhaps comes to mind. Verse 56, the sting of death is sin. If there were no sin in the world, there would be no death. Sin brought death and judgment. Verse 57, but thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. It is Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone who has delivered us from the guilt and the penalty of sin. It is Jesus Christ who at his coming in glory will change, redeem our bodies and make them like his glorious body. Philippians chapter 3 and verse 21 reads, the Lord Jesus Christ will transform, change our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. The Lord Jesus Christ, by his death and resurrection, triumphed over sin and death and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers, to all who put their trust in him, believe in him, believe his gospel. We share in his victory by faith in him, by putting our faith in him. Verse 58, therefore, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labour in the Lord is not in vain. These are strange times, but God knows the end from the beginning. And strange as it may seem to some of us, there are still people spending their days, living their lives, doing things which in the light of eternity do not matter at all. But your labour and mine in the Lord is not in vain. No, because we will receive that well done, as well as all of that I have been speaking about this morning. That's what I leave you with here in Marchwood this morning. We will all be changed.
Thank you, Eric. We can truly, I think, become optimists that as we as believers will have a powerful spiritual food chain. And that means we will want to shout it out. And so we move on to our
truth, stand and sing to broken hearts,
who can know the healing power of our awesome King of Love. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west, Jesus, the Savior to all, Lord of heaven. Yeah, we will shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west, Jesus, the Savior to all, Lord of heaven. We've been through fire, we've been through rain, we've been refined by the power of His name. We've fallen deeper in love with You. You burn the truth on our lips. We will shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west, Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven. Church with broken wings, fill this place with songs again of our God who reigns on high. By His grace again we'll fly.
Version of that song, because there are children singing and those children are our future. They too will pick up the gauntlet and take the message to their friends, to their families, and they will, as we all should, be optimistic that the gospel of our Lord will spread throughout this land and throughout the world. So let us pray. May Your love that never fails strengthen the weak, encourage the fearful, calm the anxious and heal the sick, and help us to all spread the good news in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.